Good morning, brothers and sisters. Good morning. Can I ask you to stand? Come on, let's all stand up. And why don't you just tell the people around you, you're looking more like Jesus today. Come on. You're looking more like Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. Before we come into worship, can I just ask you something? How many of you want more success in their life? Can I see a raise of hands? Yes. How many of you want more money? More blessings? Yan. How many of you guys want more friends? More friends in their life? Yes. You know what? Sometimes, or most of the time, the world tells us that having more is better, right? Having more is better. But you know what? This morning, as I was reflecting on the Word of God, I was really struck on the word from John the Baptist, which says, from John 3:30, which says, "He must increase, but I must decrease. He must increase, but I must decrease." In that way, I realized, sometimes we're so preoccupied with our prayers. Sometimes we're so preoccupied with our dreams, right? And sometimes we just forget to focus about God. But right now, this moment, I invite you to focus less on your worries, focus less on your problems, and focus more on Jesus. Because He is the source of everything that is good. He is the way, the truth, and the life, and He is all about that we worship Him, right? Amen? If you believe that, why don't you give the Lord a shout of praise? As we come into worship this morning, I want you to put your hands together and sing and dance for the Lord. Woo! Thank you, God.
Of me succeeded by the best of you.
Come on, lift it up.
Oh, oh, oh.
As we decrease, we lay down our lives to you. And this is our prayer.
So I lay me down.
Yes, God.
So I lay me down.
We lay ourselves to you, God.
So I lay me down for King.
Let us continue to focus our eyes on Jesus. Let us continue to keep our eyes on Him. And we continue to pray as we make the sign of our faith in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Jesus, we come to You as we are. We pray for more of Your presence. We pray for more of Your love, more of Your grace. Less of ourselves, less of our worries, less of our concerns, less of our pride. Right now, God, we want to focus on You. We want to learn Your ways. We want to learn how You loved. We want to learn how You lived on earth. We want to imitate You, Jesus. Lord, in each and every day, we want to be more like You. Our soul just longs to be in Your presence. Our soul longs to be in Your love. So right now, we want to give everything. We want to give all that we are. We want to set our eyes, our hearts on You. Believing that You are doing something. Believing that it's not over yet. Believing that that we are a work in progress. Right now, God, as we lift our praise, as we lift this song, as we lift up to You our hearts, our prayer is that we continue to hold on to You, because You are all that we need. And You are all that we want to be in this world. Thank You, Jesus. You came to the world You created, trading Your crown for a cross. You willingly died, Your innocent life paid the cost. You're counting Your status as nothing. The King of all kings came to serve, washing my feet, covering me with Your love. If more of You means less of me, take everything. Yes, all of You is all I need, take everything. Take it all. Where am I like?
You are my life and my treasure, the one that I can't live without. Here at Your feet, my desires and dreams I lay down.
Oh, we lay.
Here at Your feet, my desires and dreams I lay down. All of You is all I need. Take it.
your time. This is our simple prayer of surrender. Take everything, Lord. Take whatever it is that fills us and leaves no room for you in our life, Lord. Take everything that occupies the special places that only you should be occupying in our life. And Lord, as we empty ourselves, as we give more of ourselves for you, we take hold of the strong anchor of your love. We take hold of the deep roots of your word in our life. And so today, Lord, bring about the change that you want in. Bring about the tests, bring about the trials that turn into treasure, into beauty, into just a living testimony of your love in our life. Make us more like Jesus. And so, Lord, we sing to you this song of hope. That as we empty ourselves, surrender our lives to you, we become more fastened, more glued to you. We hold on to you. And so we sing.
I have this hope. An anchor for my soul through every storm, I will hold to you with endless love. All my fears wept away. Trust in you. There is hope in the promise of the cross. You gave everything to save the world you love. And this hope is an anchor for my soul. Our God will stand unshakable. There is hope in the promise of the
Sessions. Let us all welcome Brother Mike Vinas.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. It is a wonderful blessing to be with you all this morning. If you're wondering where Brother Arun is, he is now in Singapore because we have our grand feast there. And so as they would say, when the mice is away, or the mice is away, napagbaliktad ko na kaagad, ano? That when the cat is away, the mice is at play, or in our case, when the Bumbay is away, we are at play, and we're going to have fun, and we're going to be blessed by the Word of God today. Amen? Amen. Speaking of fun, can I ask you, who among you here are in any social media platform? Taas ang kamay? Okay, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, ayan, alright. If you were on social media this past week, baka may napansin kayong lumabas na news, something to do with the logo of the proposed logo for the Southeast Asian Games that will be held here in 2019. And so, I think this came out. Can we show them? Ayan. All right. Now, the moment this came out, and this was, I think, just a trial, a proposal from the government. When this came out, people from the internet right away made their own versions, and they made somehow fun of this, poking some fun and making their own versions. Sige, pakita natin. Next slide, ayan. Ganyan yan daw siya. Diba? And other businesses actually made their own ads based on that logo. Sige, next. Ayan si Pizza Hut, diba? Oh, diba? Oh, next. Oh, si Nissin Yakisoba. Talagang nakigaya na lang talaga. Next. Ayan. Pati si Cebuana Luelier. Okay? And then lastly, ayan, mga donut. You know, it's interesting how people looked at something and creatively saw things differently. Right? They looked at an image, they looked at the logo, pero iba yung nakita nila. They thought of something else. They creatively saw things differently. Friends, my prayer for you this week, as you come into your work week with your family, maybe as you face your problems and the trials that you maybe are going to go through this coming week, my prayer is that you would see, or you would creatively see things differently. That by the grace of God, that when you look at your struggles, instead of seeing setbacks, you will see stepping stones to success. That when you look at your mistakes, instead of seeing failures, you will see opportunities for growth. And when you look at your weaknesses, instead of seeing limitations, you will see the limitless power of God that could work in your life, in your situation, in your circumstances. In other words, you have to align your perception according to God's promise. You want to align how you see things to how God sees things. For His promise is this, in the second book of Corinthians, chapter 12, verse 9, let me just read it to you. It says there, God says, Jesus says, "My grace is always more than enough for you, and my power finds its full expression through your weakness." And here it is. "So I will celebrate my weaknesses, for when I am weak, I sense more deeply the mighty power of Christ living in me." Amen. Amen. Come on, if you believe that today, if you believe the power of Christ is within you, come on, give Him praise, give Him honor and glory. His grace is sufficient. His love is unending. His favor is unfailing. Amen. And if you believe this morning, let's pray our favorite prayer in the feast. Let's receiving that grace as we come in the name of the Father, the Son, of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lift up those hands again if this is something comfortable for you. And together in faith, we declare, today I receive all of God's love for me. Today I open myself to the unbounded, limitless, overflowing abundance of God's universe. Today I open myself to God's blessings, healing, and miracles. Today I open myself to God's Word so that I become more like Jesus every day. Today I proclaim that I am God's beloved. I am God's servant. I am God's powerful champion. And because I am blessing the world in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's open up our hearts and honor God's Word together as we sing.
Thy word is the lamp unto my feet and the light unto my path.
Come on, let's give the Lord a big hand. Hallelujah, Jesus. Speak to us today as you're sitting down. Touch the person beside you. Tell that person, ang ganda mo at guwapo mo ngayon. And you can sit down. Let's also give a big hand to our worship team. Thank you very much, guys, for leading us into the presence of God. I want to start off by welcoming those of you who came here for the very first time. You know who you are. Could we also welcome them by giving them a clap? Thank you so much that you are here. We know and believe that God brought you here by no accident, and that He brought you here to speak something into your life that I believe will bless you, challenge you, and change you for the days ahead. And so we hope that you would have fun today here at the feast. Also, those of you who are young people, I think we do have an ongoing session with our youth high session with the other ballroom of this hotel. So if you're young at heart and you're feeling young or young biologically, you can join them there. We have our youth gatherings as well. But also, definitely not the least, we want to welcome those of you who are joining us through Facebook Live, online, all over the Philippines, or wherever you are in the globe. We pray that whatever you hear from this place, from this platform, will also speak specifically into your situation, into your heart, that you would be inspired, blessed, and be all that God wants you to be. Let's give them a big hand. Come on. All right, are you ready? Let's have this talk today, believing and thinking that it's Brother Arun preaching. Yes? So I will count on your response and I will count on your engagement with this message as if he was here, because he's probably watching online anyway. Do you agree? Okay, all right. So today we're going to continue our series entitled Breaking News. And in the last how many weeks, we've been talking about the Gospels. Can we name them? Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Very good, children. Okay. Now, in the last how many weeks, we've been talking about the authorship of these Gospels, of who authored it, who wrote it. We talked about the audience of each of these Gospels, who they were writing to. And we also talked about their main message, and many more, actually. Today, we're going to zero in specifically in the Gospel of Luke. Everybody say Luke. It's Luke, not Luke. Okay, hindi Luke yun, okay? But here in the Gospel of Luke. Everybody say Luke. All right. Before we go into that, tanong ko lang sa inyo mabilis. Sino sa inyo dito yung mga empleyado, taas ang kamay? Employees, very good. Among you are entrepreneurs, raise your hand. Okay. Now, whether you'd be a employee or an entrepreneur, we all know that an organization, a company, a group, especially if it's established, they have to have a mission statement. Pakisabi nga, mission statement. Mission statements are so important because it defines the purpose and the identity of the organization. In fact, ang mga companies, pinaggagastosan nila yan. They will fly their executives, their leaders, into a resort, to a hotel or a retreat center, put them there for 3 days to brainstorm and to craft that mission statement, that one line. And they spend so much money, maybe even millions, to simply craft 9, 10, 11, 12 words for that mission statement. So it's so important, and they really take it seriously. I'll give you some examples. So here's what we're going to do, okay? I'm going to share with you a mission statement of a company or an organization, and then I want you to guess, just simply guess, an intelligent guess of what this organization or company is. Are you with me? Yes? Don't worry, I'll give you clues along the way kung ano yung mga kumpanya na yan. Okay? So first, let's show them. First mission statement, to give people the power to share and make the world more open and connected. Globe, wow, talagang mukha kang Globe employee, no? Kumakaya, Globe. Well, actually, it probably, maybe close to Globe because its logo is also color blue and you can find it on your phone. Facebook. Sige, pakita natin. Yes, palakpakan ang mga sumagot ng Facebook. Very good. Next is this. And the earlier session got this, so I'm hoping that you get it also. To organize the world's information and make it universally accessible and useful. Google, very good. Give yourselves a big hand. Diba? Pagpasok mo sa computer, pag open mo ng browser mo, it's most likely Google. Next, to make people happy. Simple lang. To make people happy. Ano yan? Jollibee. Close. It's actually, pakita natin, Walt Disney. In fact, yung mission statement na yan, dapat yan ang mga mission statement ng mga husbands. To make your wives happy. Because happy wife? Oh, di ba mas babae yung mga sumasagot kasi sila'y nakakatanggap? Okay? Amen ba yan, mga husbands? Amen. Wala talaga, agree. Ito, next. To spread ideas. Those of you who go to YouTube or watch this online, that's a clue already. That's this organization. To spread ideas. Pwede yan, sir, pero hindi po yan. See it? Okay, pakita natin. Baka ma-recognize nyo ito. TED Talks. All right? It's a good resource for learning from different speakers also. How about this? And maybe some of you, I've found people that they're actually addicted to this, na kailangan araw-araw iniinom nila to. Yan na yung clue, ha? To refresh the world. Oh, sa kulay pa lang, di ba? Pulang-pula. Sige, pakita mo. Coca-Cola. Ayan. And, how about this? Can we show them? To make disciples. Is that correct? Can we show them? Yes. Give the Lord a big hand. To make disciples. That's our mission statement here at the feast. Question. What would you say is the mission statement of Jesus? You see, in the Gospel of Luke, he would say that the mission statement of Jesus was this: to proclaim good news to the poor. Pakisabi nga with me? To proclaim good news to the poor. And he talks about this right at the beginning of his gospel at Luke chapter 4, where Jesus actually quotes from the book of Isaiah, and he says this to a crowd. Can we have it on screen and let's read it all together? 1, 2, 3, go. The Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to what? To proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom from the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. So the main message of the Gospel of Luke is for Jesus to proclaim good news. Everybody say good news. Tingnan mo yung katabi mo, mukha bang good news yan sa buhay mo. Okay? Hopefully it is. So Luke wants to proclaim the good news of our Lord Jesus Christ to the poor. Now, before we go deeply more into that in this message, let me give you some quick facts about Luke. In fact, there are three of them. How many? Three. First is this. Luke, I was actually not an apostle. In fact, maybe you know it already now, most of the gospel writers really were not apostles. So you're probably wondering, then how can they write about Jesus? Paano nila nasusulat kung ano nangyari sa buhay ni Jesus if they weren't there, if they weren't first eyewitnesses to the life, ministry, death, and resurrection of Jesus?
Well, for Luke, this was how he did it. He actually copied from the Gospel of Mark. Truth be told, that was what happened. In fact, there was a common source also that Luke and Matthew used na pinagkopyahan nila to write their own Gospels. In other words, lahat sila nagkopyahan lang talaga. They just made it their own way, their own style, their own version. Kaya next time, may nagsabi sa inyo, lalo sa mga students dito, bawal mangopya. Sabi mo, mga gospel writers yun, nakipagkopyahan. Nebiro lang, hindi natin tinuturo yan sa feast, okay? Hindi tama mangopya, okay? But the gospel writers here really worked together. They were inspiration to one another, and that's why they were able to write these gospels. Here's my point. If you want to grow in life, if you want to progress, if you want to become a success, you've got to check the people that you hang out with. Because you've got to hang out with the right people. You have a specific dream, you have a specific goal. Check. Are the people around you, are the people journeying with you, from your family to your friends, are they leading you closer and closer to that goal, to that dream? Yes? Second, Luke was a doctor. Doctor pala siya. In fact, it was just recently that I connected in my head, and I'll be honest with you, ngayon ko lang nagets. Kaya pala St. Luke's, yung ospital. As in, ngayon ko lang talaga, wow, praise the Lord, such life-changing news. Talagang, yun pala ang tawag nyo, kaya pala St. Luke's, kasi si St. Luke, the gospel writer, was a doctor. In fact, mapapansin nyo na yan. When it comes to the Gospel of Mark and the Gospel of Luke pays more attention to detail. Kasi mas learned, mas aral si Luke kesa kay Mark, I guess in terms of formal training and formal schooling. And somehow you can also see this, that it's obvious in his writing style because Luke writes in polished Greek. So not in conversational or colloquial Greek, mas highfaluting siguro, mas affluent yung Greek niya. Bakit? Because he was trying to speak to the high upper class or educated Gentile Greek Christians. So he was using what he had, he was using what he was good at to proclaim the gospel. And the point I have here simply is this, that sometimes you find yourself with gifts, with skills, with talents, and you're wondering, Lord, why do I have this? Or maybe you're wondering, ito yung trabaho mo. This is where God has planted you, in this sphere of society, in this area of life. Why am I here, you wondering? The truth is really God ordained that. God designed that for your purpose, or for His purpose actually. That the gifts, skills, and talents that you have, the areas in which God has planted you in, He will use that as your strengths. He will use that for His glory, for His purpose. Amen? Third thing, Luke actually wrote two books. The Gospel of Luke and the Book of Acts. And it's more like a part one, part two kind of thing. Okay? Now, yung book one was about the acts of Jesus, and book two was about the acts of the followers of Jesus. Are you following me? And just like any great story, usually, it's a trilogy, di ba? Di ba? Every great story, tatlo yan. Madalas, sa pelikula, nakikita natin, trilogy yan madalas. Pag naalam mong may part one, tapos may part two, ay, you can bet, may part three yan. And truth be told, really, the Gospel of Luke was part one, the Book of Acts was part two, and guess what? Part three, or book three, is actually in the works right now. It's being written. And it's based on your life. It's based on your acts. It's based on your work. Because your life is a gospel. And our prayer is that your life proclaims the good news of our Lord Jesus Christ in your family, in your finances, in the company that you work for. That all of this, as people see you and see how you live your life, that it actually points to Christ. Your life, my friends, is a gospel. So be careful how you live your life, because you may be the only gospel that someone ever needs or someone ever reads. Amen? Amen. Let's give the Lord a big hand. Come on. Elbow the person beside you. Tell that person, your life is a gospel. Your life should be good news. All right. You learning something so far? All right, good. So let's go back to that mission statement. Let's go back to the main message of Luke in his gospel. That is, again, to proclaim good news to the poor. And let's somehow qualify what poor means, okay? See, this message will be a bit more heady, a bit more information, but my prayer is that from the information, you will find inspiration. Yes? Okay. So, Luke lifts actually that line to proclaim the good news to the poor. Kinopya niya yan. Kinopya rin niya yan. Talaga mukhang nangungopya lang talaga siya parati. He lifted that from Isaiah in the Old Testament. And Isaiah wrote those words in the Hebrew language. So poor, actually in the Hebrew language, meant more than just financial poverty. Sa ngayon kasi, pag sinabi nating poor, ang una nating naiisip, yung mahirap, those who are materially or financially poor. But actually, in that context, in that time, the Hebrew word for poor is actually ani. Everybody say ani. Okay? And ani means someone who is not valued in society. These are the people who are neglected, who are forgotten, who are outcasts of society. So Jesus, in his time, in that ancient Jewish culture, when they say poor, they actually mean the neglected, the forgotten, and the outcast. And you could somehow classify them into five kinds of people. Five kinds of poor people. And these are the five. First are those who are materially poor. So that explains itself already, right? Second are women and children. See, during that time, they were considered poor because they couldn't own any kind of property. At that time, only men could actually own land or any kind of business or property. So women and children had nothing to their name. So they were considered poor. Third, the sick. See, people believed then that if you're sick, that means you are cursed. So people would distance themselves from the sick kasi baka mahawa sila nung sakit nila at baka mahawa sila dun sa curse that they have. So they were considered also poor. Fourth, the Gentiles. See, Gentiles are those who are non-Jews. So they didn't really necessarily follow Jewish law. And because they didn't follow Jewish law, the Jews saw them as unclean. Again, they were pushed away, set aside from society, considering them poor. And lastly, sinners. In the Jewish mindset, if you're a sinner, that means you are hated by God. Yun yung pag-iisip nila. And so again, because they were hated by God, ay, hindi yung makikisama sa'yo, bahala ka dyan. I'm gonna disregard you. I'm not gonna remember, you're gonna be forgotten, you're gonna be set aside. And again, that's why they were considered poor. Friends, for many today, Christianity and the church is like an exclusive club of people who are so-called perfect, of people who have it all together. In fact, sometimes we treat it as, we treat church or we treat community as an elite circle of holy people. And I find it sad that sometimes we actually make people feel this way, that we give out that vibe that sinners are not welcome here. But I praise be to God that here at the feast, we try our very best to make sure that every kind of person who walks into our gatherings, who walks coming into our LGs, that we make sure that they are welcomed, that they feel that they belong, that this is home for them. And we try our very best, from the sinner to the saint, from the famous to the faceless, from the hurting to the healed, all are welcome here. Yes? In fact, this is our belief. You don't have to believe to belong. You don't have to have it all together. Hindi kailangan lahat ng bagay sa buhay mo maayos for you to be part of this community, to be part of this journey along with us. Because definitely, none of us have it all together. What we know is this. Are you listening? What we know is that it's Jesus who holds all things together. And so, like Him, we're simply gonna try our best by His grace to love you, serve you, and help you in any way that we can in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And that is the heart of the gospel. In fact, when Luke speaks of this, he's simply saying that if you're sinning, if you're struggling, if you've been set aside by society, you have a Savior, and that Savior sprints or runs after you. Amen. We have a Savior, and that Savior runs after us. And so we said that Luke is speaking to these five kinds of poor people in that time that I feel are still very much relevant today. And so what we're going to do is we're going to look not into all those five, but we're going to look into three out of those five kinds of people and see the good news that Luke is somehow proclaiming to these people. And somehow maybe we could also learn something and find that good news in our lives. So are you with me? Yes? First group of the poor people that Luke is communicating to are those who are materially poor. You know, 9 years ago, there was only just one feast led by Brother Bo. And at that time, we started branching out. We started planting and building feasts in different areas, in malls, in cinemas, in event venues like these. Let me ask you, who among you still remember the day or you were attending already in the time when we were still in festival mall cinema? Taas ang kamay? All right, very good. And it's good that there are a few hands, and there are more hands that are not raised, because that means we're reaching more people. We're reaching new people. Good. So the feast was growing at that time in different places, different areas. And some people somehow brought their genuine concern, and they asked this. They said, you know, it's great how the feast is blessing so many people, but I noticed that the feast is geared more towards the middle class. And they asked, meron ba tayong mga feasts that will cater to the lower classes? Okay. So hold that question, and I'll answer that in a few moments from now. You see, if you look at history, the revolutions that really changed the world and impacted society were the revolutions that began from the middle class. And it somehow impacted or influenced the upper class and eventually trickled down to the lower class. So our philosophy was that when our middle class members eventually get blessed and their lives are changed, they will eventually reach out to the lower classes. And that is exactly, my friends, that is exactly what is happening today, 9 years after starting the feasts in different areas. Because today, we have feasts in city jails. We have feasts in drug rehab centers. We have feasts specifically for poor children. We have feasts in Hong Kong and Abu Dhabi that caters to domestic helpers. So it's really amazing that if you are coming to the feast, you're part of this whole movement that doesn't just reach out to this class, but to everyone. And we get to do this. We get to be part of what God is doing through the feast. Amen? Can you touch the person beside you? Tell that person, we get to do this. And so, this is the same reason why Brother Bo, myself, and other financial educators or financial professionals here at the Feast have a passion for financial literacy. Because we want to be able to help manage or help people manage their own money so that eventually they can break free from poverty and eventually become a blessing to many. You see, if you find yourself today as part of this group, those who are materially poor, if you find yourself going through some financial tightness, financial struggles in your life, Luke's good news is this, that we have a God who is a faithful provider, and we have a God who wants to lift you up from material poverty. Amen? Amen? But here's the thing. We have a God who will lift you up from material poverty, and He will do so with the help of those who have more. See, Luke again was speaking to the more affluent, to the upper class Gentile Christians, encouraging them to also love and care for the poor, that if they have more in life, they should be able to bless more of those who do not have more. And so the same is true for us. For those of you who are blessed, For those of you more fortunate who have more in life, here's the good news for you. The good news for you is that loving the poor isn't just what you do, but it's who you are. Loving the poor is not just an activity that you do, it's an identity that we live by. Amen? It's who we are. It's part of our DNA. Okay? Second group that Luke speaks to in his gospel are women and children, and specifically women. You see, during ancient Jewish society, women and children were not counted, meaning they were invisible. They weren't somehow considered as people, actually. And the evidence of this is when we read the story when Jesus multiplied bread and fish. Yung sa inyo nakakaalala nun, taas sa kamay? Okay, remember that story? Jesus takes 5 loaves and 2 fishes, multiplies them, and feeds the multitude. At the end of that passage, it says, there were what? There were 5,000 men, not counting women and children. Why? Because women at that time were considered second-class citizens. Mababa ang tingin nila sa mga babae nung panahon na yon. And that's why Luke proclaims this good news to women, the truth that Jesus values women. In fact, we see this in Luke chapter 8, where Luke speaks of the women who follows the ministry of Jesus. They actually play a part in the ministry of Jesus. And it says here, the 12 were with him, and also some women who had been cured of evil spirits and diseases. And he names them. Mary called Magdalene, from whom 7 demons had come out, Joanna, the wife of Chuza, the manager of Herod's household, Susanna, and many others. And it says there, these women were helping to support them out of their own means. 2 quick facts when it comes to ancient Jewish society pertaining to women. See, during that time, the education of women was frowned upon. Their belief was, ang paaralin lang natin, yung mga lalaki. So rabbis, teachers, would only select men to be their students, to be their disciples. But Jesus disrupted all of that because he didn't only teach and educate men, he also taught women. And 2 of his students was Mary and Martha. One more thing about ancient Jewish culture. To them, women cannot be eyewitnesses in court. They cannot testify to the truth. Because again, they weren't considered even as people. So when the Gospel of Luke and other Gospels spoke of women being the first eyewitnesses to the resurrection of Jesus, it was a huge statement. It was a huge shock to the Jewish world because it was somehow saying that with Christianity, women are valued. Women are given significance and importance. So my question is this. Are you listening? Yes? Do we value our women today? Husbands, do you cherish your wives? Oh, pero mahina ah. Yes. Parang pilit na pilit, di ba? Wives, is it true? Naku, mas lalong mahina. Okay, usap na lang kayo dyan, okay, mamaya. Children, do you honor your mother? Yes. You know, I find it sad today that we live in a day and age where women sometimes are treated and projected as objects of pleasure. And evidence to that is actually in 2015, there was a survey that was made. And it's not something to be proud of, it's not something to be happy about, but it's a startling reality that we have to consider and address. And it is this, that we were found to be number one, Philippines, number one in the world for most time spent on the internet watching pornography. Number one. Talo pa natin yung iba. So I want to just issue this reality to all of us today to think about and consider, and I want to challenge the men here with this. Real men respect women. Real men respect women. Real men respect women. So if you're sitting beside a man, can you check if that's a real man? Real men respect women. Can I hear a shout from all the women in the house? Real men respect women. Third people group. Third poor people group that Luke speaks to. So he speaks to those who are materially poor, women and children, and the third are sinners. So taas ang ating kamay. Sino sa inyo mga makasalanan dito, taas? Okay, thank you. See, I'm a sinner, you're a sinner. The one sitting beside you is a sinner.
Okay.
We're all sinners. But what Luke speaks of and what the other gospel speaks of is that Jesus is a friend of sinners. If you look at the itinerary of Jesus, you will see that Jesus went out with the worst kind of people. Ang mahilig niyang barkada at kasama parati whenever he would dine would be tax collectors, prostitutes, public sinners. And we find this in Luke chapter 15, a very famous chapter. And it says there, now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus. So imagine that. They were all together, lahat sila magkumpul-kumpul, going around Jesus. And Jesus was speaking, and this was their hangout time. They were just enjoying themselves in the company of Jesus. All these sinners together. Then suddenly, the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." Talagang nagparinig sila. It was as if they were saying, "Why are you hanging out with these people? Why are you with them? Don't you know that these are people who you shouldn't be with? They are sinners." So the Pharisees were out to shun and shame these sinners, but Jesus had a different agenda. In that gathering where sinners were around him and these religious, self-righteous Jewish leaders were there, he shocks them because he shares three stories, three parables in this Luke chapter 15. And I call it the Lost Trilogy. Because he speaks of first the lost coin, and then the lost sheep, and then the lost son. And each of these stories speak of the truth, speak and paint a picture of a Savior who seeks out the sinner. Of a Savior who runs after the lost, the least, and the last. A Savior who saves the worst of sinners. And we know the most popular of them all. Which among the three? The lost son. The parable of the prodigal son. And we know this story well, where the younger son demands for his inheritance. And in doing so, disrespects his father, runs away, leaves his home to a faraway land, and splurges and spends all his money in sinful, loose living. When he comes to the point na naubuso na siya, nawaldas na niya lahat ng pera, he had nothing to eat. And he was faced with pig food. And there, he realized, I'm better off being a worker in my father's house. I don't want this life anymore. I will go back to him, apologize, and seek employment in his kingdom. And so on his way back to his father's house, to his father's place, we read this in Luke 15, verse 20. It says there, but while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and, filled with compassion for him, did what? He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. You know, this reminds me of a story of my good friend, Brother Audie. He's the feast builder for Feast Bay Area. And he was telling me that when he was 12 years old, in the 1990s, he got into a major car accident. And this is what happened. Without his parents knowing, he stole his parents' car. 12 years old. He stole his parents' car with his ate, and they went for a joyride around the city. So at some point in the night, they were at Ortigas Avenue, corner EDSA. And out of nowhere, there meron biglang eight-wheeler truck who lost its brakes. So they collide, this truck collides with a car behind them, And eventually they get hit also, and other cars as well, to the point that there were about 8 cars that were involved in this accident. There was total wreckage all over. Good thing was that they came out of that accident in one piece. Hindi sila masyado nasaktan. But right away in that moment when they came out of the car, yung ate niya called their parents, told them what happened, and asked them to come. And so right away, if you're a parent, I'm sure in the middle of the night, magigising ka, and you realize that your kids are not at home, and they came into an accident, what would we do? You would go there right away. And so 15, 20 minutes, they were there. And my friend Odi was telling me, you know what, while we were waiting, that was the longest 15, 20 minutes of my life. Kasi kinakabahan na ako. Nakabahan na ako, papagalitan nila ako, they're gonna punish me, they're gonna shout at me for what I did. 12 years old, right? And so the parents get to the accident scene. They arrive there, they arrive from a distance, and right away, they went running. Out of the car, they came running to Odi and to the sister, and instead of shouting at them, instead of getting mad, they simply hugged them, embraced them, kissed them, and thanked God that they were safe. They thought they will get the pounding of a lifetime for what they did, but instead, they got a pounding of love for what has happened. Friends, in this parable, in the parable of the prodigal son, the father ran. But in Jewish society, fathers do not run. Because to them, it was beneath their dignity. But this father's run towards the prodigal son simply showed us that that was an expression of his relentless love for the son. And it showed us a picture of a God, of a Savior who sprints towards the sinner. Now, when we are broken, when we are hurting, when we are lost, a long way off, when God sees us, He's gonna come running after us. He's gonna come chasing after us. He's gonna come to us to heal us, to mend our broken hearts, and to bring us closer back to Him in Jesus' name. A Savior who sprints to the sinner. So friends, maybe today you've squandered your life away. Maybe you've turned your back against God, going your own way, and you realize that suddenly your way goes nowhere. And you're somehow ashamed to come back home. I sense someone needs to hear this today. That if that's you, may I encourage you to come back home. Come back home to God, because when God sees you coming, He'll be the first one running. He'll be the first one to come to you, to welcome you home, to accept you, to celebrate with you that once you were dead and now you are alive, once you were lost and now you are found. And the truth is this, there is no guilt in your heart that could ever be greater than the grace of God. Amen. There is no guilt of whatever you're feeling right now could ever be greater than the love, the mercy, and grace of God for you. Nothing can change that. Nothing you could do in your past or in your life could ever change how God sees you and loves you. Amen. Amen. There is no guilt in your heart that will ever be greater than the grace of God. I can invite you all to stand. I want to end this message today with this statement. Humility is the key to the kingdom. Can you say that with me? Humility is the key to the kingdom. And this truth we saw in that parable, that the reason why the son was welcomed back into his father's household was because he humbled himself, sought repentance, and he was welcomed back. And Luke reiterates this truth right at the very end of his gospel, right at the very end of Jesus' life. And he speaks of two criminals hanging on the cross with Jesus. And it says here, one of the criminals who hang there hurled insults at him, at Jesus. And he said, "Aren't you the Messiah? save yourself and us. But the other criminal rebuked him. Don't you fear God, he said, since you are under the same sentence? We are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong. Then he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus answered, truly I tell you today, you will be with me in paradise. So picture this cross. Jesus was surrounded by criminals, one on each side. One criminal mocks him in disbelief, in pride, saying that hindi naman ikaw si God eh, kasi hindi mo nga kami masave. But one criminal repents in all humility and faith. And because of this criminal's repentance, at the very last moment, he was given the key to the kingdom. Friends, my point is this. Pride will keep you running and rebelling to its bitter end. But humility will lead you to repentance and redemption. Let me say that again. Pride will keep you running and rebelling away from God to its bitter end, like that other criminal. But it is humility that will lead you to repentance, redemption, and salvation in your life. So ask yourself, maybe you've been running from God. Maybe you've been rebelling against Him. Maybe there is an issue in your life that God wants to address, but He can't seem to do so because you keep wrestling with Him with your pride. Ayaw magpatalo. You know the right thing. You know His way, but you choose to go your own way. So maybe it's time for you to stop running, to stop rebelling, and to stop wrestling with God, and to simply tap out in all humble surrender and says, Lord, ayaw na makipag-away sa'yo. Kayo na po bahala. To submit to God in all humility and admit to our spiritual poverty. What spiritual poverty is to simply say that, Lord, I am a sinner. I am nothing without you, and I am in constant, desperate need of your grace. That we cannot do things on our own. Think about this. Could it be that the only thing necessary for the next victory in your life is humility? Let me say that again. Could it be that the only thing necessary for the next victory, for the next breakthrough, for the next great thing to happen in your life, the only thing necessary for that to happen, maybe you need humility? Because humility is the key to the kingdom. And when I say kingdom, I don't just mean heaven or a physical location. When we say kingdom, the gospel pertains it to the reign of God in our lives. So given that truth, humility then is the key to God's expansion of His kingdom, of His reign in our lives. You want to see more of God move powerfully in your life? Maybe we have to enter into a disposition where we're humble enough to say that we can't do this on our own, that we have it all wrong and that He's got it all right, and we're going to surrender to Him in all humility so that the kingdom of God, His reign, His power, His grace, His love will gain more ground in our lives, invade our hearts, invade our situations, and bring it towards the victory that He desires for us. Humility is the key to the kingdom. So if you're ready today to submit in all humility and admit to your spiritual poverty that you need God, I can invite you to lift up your hands once more. This is something comfortable for you. Just close your eyes with me and say this prayer. Say, Lord Jesus, I am a mess and I am nothing without you. In my life, may you increase as I decrease. You are all I need. So take all of me. And in all that I do, make me more like you. Make me more like you. Make me more like you. In your name we pray. Amen. Keep those hands up high. Let this be your prayer. Let this be your song to God today. In all humility we sing.
If more of you means less of me, take everything. Yes, all of you is all I need. Take everything.
Come on, sing it out.
If more of you means less of me, take everything. Yes, all of you is all I need. Take everything. Oh Lord, change me like only you can. Here in my heart, in your hands. So Father, I pray, make me more like Jesus. This world is dying to know who you are. You've shown us the way to your
disposition of we are always in spiritual poverty, needing you, desperate for you in our lives, for your grace. So we thank you that in all our needs, you will meet them exceedingly and abundantly, Lord Jesus. We declare this today in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's give the Lord a big hand. Hallelujah. Praise God. I invite you to give a handshake or to a hug to as much people around you. Just tell that person, you are more like Jesus. Jesus, you're more like Jesus. You're more like Jesus. Let's give the Lord a big hand once more. Hallelujah. You can be seated. Before we go into our announcements, I just want to somehow encourage you around our giving. One more quick fact I want to share with you about Luke. was that he dedicated his writing, his two books, the Gospel of Luke and the Book of Acts, he dedicated it to a guy named Theophilus. Pakisabi nga? Theophilus. And we read this in Luke chapter 1, right away at the beginning of his gospel. He says, I too decided to write an orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus. So, sino nga ba yan si Theophilus? Parang ngayon natin narinig yan. Okay? Bible scholars believe that it was Theophilus who funded the ministry and the writing of Luke. So, during that time, wala pa yung MS Word, di ba? Where you can write your book. Wala pa yung Photoshop to lay out the cover of that book. Wala pang Amazon nun to publish your book online. And so, people needed help. Luke needed help to get this project running. And it was Theophilus who invested his money for the book to be written and for it to go out to bless the world. I can imagine Theophilus now in heaven thinking, oh, that was a good investment at that time. Because it was the Gospel of Luke that eventually, over the generations, blessed so much lives, brought people closer to Christ, and saved so many souls. And the reason I'm sharing this to you today is that we all have this wonderful opportunity to make an investment in the kingdom of God through our giving. That like Theophilus, we can actually sow a seed and be part of what God is doing. And we know that our investment goes a long way. Goes a long way. Like the book of Luke that blesses and changes lives, our investment, our seed, the money that we put into these envelopes goes to eventually continuing the gospel being proclaimed here at the feast. For lives to continue to be changed, to be blessed, and to be transformed. And so I want to encourage you today, make the best investment in your life that will reap you not just earthly rewards, but eternal returns. Amen?
Amen.
So invest in the kingdom through your giving. So give your best today to the Lord and see how this investment will give you so much more in return in Jesus' name. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Announcements, Sister Bebs?
All right. So at this point, we would like to invite those who have attended the feast for the very first time. Can I see a raise of hands of those who have attended for the first time? Any new attendees in the house? All right. Yes. All right. Okay, let's cover these people. Invite them to stand up, please. We would like to pray for you. All right. Don't be shy. Ayan. Thank you. Thank you so much for being here. So, everybody, let's extend our hands over them and pray over them. Okay? Father, we lift up to you these people who began their journey in knowing you more through the feast. Lord, bless them tremendously. Bless them in every aspect of their life. We pray, Lord, that they would feel that they have gained a new home through the feast and a new family through these people around them, Lord. And make this come again, make them come again next week and bring new people to bless, to serve, and to just bring God closer. This we pray in Jesus' name, amen. All right, amen. So later on, we would like you to go to the tower wing in our new attendees area for a free gift later on after the feast. All right. And so the announcements. So our first announcement is for our annual solo parents retreat. We call all the solo parents to join the annual retreat happening on August 31 to September 1 at San Damiano Spirituality Center in Tagaytay City. Now, the speaker for this retreat will be Father Mario Rivera, who is the parish priest of the Birhen ng Turumba, Pakil, Laguna. And the registration fee for this retreat will be $1,850. And for more information, you may contact or approach Sister Juvie Ramirez at the Tower Wing. And any couples out there? Can I see a raise of hands? Yung mga couples, husbands, and wives. All right, so we invite you to the Lux Retreat happening on September 8 and 9, 2018 at Angel's Hills Retreat Center in Tagaytay City. Create once-in-a-lifetime memories and experience personal growth like never before. I think the investment fee is here. It's 4,500 per couple. Everyone is welcome, regardless of your beliefs, of your background. And, you know, here you will learn how husbands and wives can actually submit to each other. All right? Mutually, okay? Ayun. So you can just approach our couples ministry table in the tower wing. And we would also like to invite you to our feast worship night. It's a night of course, prayer and praise. Okay, so feast worship night is happening on September 23, 2018 here at the Bellevue Manila Hotel featuring Feast Worship and Brother Bo Sanchez. Tickets will be available. It are already available, right?
It's available online through lightfam.com. So it's just now for online ticket selling. In fact, tickets are easily being purchased already online, so medyo paubos na. So if you want to be there for September 23, we want to encourage you, log in online and you'll be able to buy the tickets online either through credit card payment or bank deposit, but it's all done online through lightfam.com.
All right, and it's only 500 pesos per ticket. All right, so we hope to see you there. And lastly, we also call upon you who would love to serve through any ministry here in the feast. You are very much welcome to lend your talents, your time, perhaps your treasure. but we would like to invite you to serve with us. It's a fun community. It's a fun group. It's, you know, it'll definitely change your life if you serve the Lord through the feast. Amen?
Yes. Amen.
All right. And lastly, for those who would like to be prayed over for whatever concern, whatever you want to pray for, you could just approach our ministers at the Tower Wing so you could be prayed over and you would be blessed more. All right?
Thank you very much, Bevs. Can I invite you all to stand? Were you blessed today?
Yes.
Amen. It was a blessing to be with you all again this morning. Can I invite you to lift up your love offering envelopes? Just allow me to lead you in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for how you've been so, so good to us, for how you've blessed us with so much more than what we expect. Lord, we continue to make this investment in your kingdom, believing, Lord God, that this goes to advancing the gospel, leading more people closer to you. And we thank you that we get to be part of all of that. We are making an impact in the lives of people through this giving. And we thank you, God, that you're using this to bless so many more people. So God, we just thank you. We surrender to you the week ahead of us. May we find ourselves once again here next week with so much reason to thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Come in front, drop your love offering envelopes, and let's get to sing in God's presence.
I have a future. I have a destiny that is yet awaiting me. My life is over. A new beginning's just begun. I have a hope. I have this hope.
God has a plan. It's not to harm me, but it's to prosper me and to hear me when I call. His intercedes for me, working all things for my good. Oh, transmaker, I have this hope. Will yet praise Him, my great Redeemer. I will yet stand up and give Him glory with my life. He takes my darkness and He turns it into light. I will yet praise Him, my Lord, my God. My God is for me. He's not against me. So tell me, shall I be? He's prepared for me. Great words, He'll help me to come in. I have a hope.
I have a hope.
I will yet praise Him, my great Redeemer. I will yet stand up and give Him glory with my life. He takes my darkness and He turns it into light. I will yet praise Him. Lord, my God, I will praise Him, my great Redeemer. I will
Good afternoon, brothers and sisters in Christ. Let us include in our prayers the following intentions flashed on the screen. Welcome to our Eucharistic celebration. We are now on the 21st Sunday in Ordinary Time. Our Mass presider is Reverend Father Ed Fernandez. Please stand and join the choir in singing our entrance song.
Thank you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Coming together as God's family, with confidence let us ask our Father's forgiveness, for He is full of gentleness and compassion. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
And may Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
God, who caused the minds of the faithful to unite in a single purpose, grant your people to love what you command and to desire what you promise, that amid the uncertainties of this world, our hearts may be fixed on that place where true gladness is found. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. Please be seated and listen to the Word of God.
A reading from the book of Joshua. Joshua gathered together all the tribes of Israel at Shechem, summoning their elders, their leaders, their judges, and their officers. When they stood in ranks before God, Joshua addressed all the people. If it does not please you to serve the Lord, decide today whom you will serve. The gods your fathers served beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose country you are now dwelling. As for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. But the people answered, "Far be it from us to forsake the Lord for the service of other gods. For it was the Lord our God who brought us and our fathers up and out of the land of Egypt, out of a state of slavery. He performed those great miracles before our very eyes and protected us along our entire journey and among the peoples through whom we passed. Therefore, we also will serve the Lord, for He is our God." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Taste and see the goodness of the Lord.
Taste and see the goodness of the Lord.
I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall be ever in my mouth. Let my soul glory in the Lord. The lowly will hear me and be glad.
Taste and see the goodness of the Lord.
The Lord has eyes for the just and ears for their cry. The Lord confronts the evildoers to destroy remembrance of them from the earth.
Taste and see the goodness of the Lord.
When the just cry out, the Lord hears them, and from all their distress, He rescues them. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted, and those who are crushed in spirit, He saves.
Taste and see the goodness of the Lord.
Many are the troubles of the just one, but out of them all the Lord delivers him. He watches over all his bones. Not one of them shall be broken.
Taste and see the goodness of the Lord.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Ephesians. Brothers and sisters, be subordinate to one another out of reverence for Christ. Wives should be subordinate to their husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is head of his wife, just as Christ is head of the church, he himself the Savior of the body. As the church is subordinate to Christ, so wives should be subordinate to their husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ loved the church and handed himself over for her to sanctify her, cleansing her by the bath of water with the word, that he might present to himself the church in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. So also husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. For no one hates his own flesh, but rather nourishes and cherishes it, even as Christ does the church, because we are members of his body. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and his mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This is a great mystery, but I speak in reference to Christ and the church. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please stand.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
let us acclaim. Your words, Lord, are spirit and life. You have the words of everlasting life. Your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Many of Jesus' disciples who were listening said, "This saying is hard. Who can accept it?" Since Jesus knew that his disciples were murmuring about this, he said to them, "Does this shock you? What if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? It is the Spirit that gives life. Well, the flesh is of no avail. The words I've spoken to you are spirit and life, but there are some of you who do not believe." Jesus knew from the beginning the ones who would not believe and the one who would betray him. And he said, "For this reason I have told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted him by my Father." As a result of this, many of his disciples returned to their former way of life and no longer accompanied him. Jesus then said to the 12, "Do you also want to leave?" Simon Peter answered him, "Master, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and are convinced that you are the Holy One of God." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Please be seated.
Good afternoon to everyone. Kindly greet your seatmates with a smile. Good afternoon. Merong isang ale na nag-confess no, sa akin one time. No? Sinabi niya, "Father, ito po yung mga kasalanan ko. I'm sorry for this, for this. I'm sorry, Father, kasi marami na hong meetings sa simbahan, sa parokya na hindi ko na po napupuntahan. I'm so sorry, hindi na ako nakaka-attend ng mga meetings." Sabi ko, "Oh, bakit? Anong dahilan?" "Eh, Father, ang daming trabaho sa bahay. Yung mga bata, lumalaki na. Ang dami ng needs. Nagluluto ako, naglalaba. Yung asawa ko din po, inaasikaso ko." And she was surprised to my question. Sabi kong ganun sa kanya, "So what's wrong? Anong masama no, kung inuna mo ang pamilya mo?" Mga kapatid, ito po ang paglilingkod ng isang Kristiyano sa simbahan. We serve God, we serve the church by being true to our vocation. I am a priest. I might be a teacher, I might be a doctor, I might be an engineer, but the best way for me to serve the church and to serve God is to serve God for who I am as a priest. Kayo din po, kung kayo po ay nanay, kayo po ay tatay, ang pinakamaganda na paglilingkod na maibibigay nyo sa Diyos at sa simbahan ay yung tayo po ay magpakatotoo sa ating pagiging nanay, tatay, at asawa. Kung may iba kayong paglilingkod, kung meron kayong ibang ginagawa sa community, sa simbahan, ang prioridad po ng isang Kristiyano ay ang kanyang pamilya. Amen? That's your priority. If ever you will go to heaven, if ever you will be a saint as a father or as a mother, as a spouse. Yan po ang una niyong trabaho. So Joshua, in our first reading, said it very well. Sabi niyang ganon, I know those in the community are familiar with this famous line from Joshua. Sabi niyang ganon, he gathered the leaders of Israel and he told them, this is a very brave proclamation of allegiance to God. Sabi niyang ganon, "As for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. You don't want to serve God? It's up to you. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. Can we repeat it? As for me and my household, we will, one more time, with feelings. Pwede ba yung mga dinig hanggang Tagaytay? How can you serve the Lord? How can you serve the community? Serve God as a good, true father, as a good, true mother, as a good, true spouse. Kasi alam nyo, pag pinunan nyo yan, ginawa nyo yung tungkulin nyo na yan, bilang nanay, bilang tatay, bilang asawa, that's the most basic eh. And everything will follow. Nakakalungkot, maraming magulang, iba ang pananaw nila sa paglilingkod. Para sa kanila, pag nabigyan nila ng gadget yung anak nila, magulang na sila. Pag na-provide nila yung mga luho ng anak nila, magulang na sila. Hindi po. Hindi po yan, no? Ang pagiging magulang, you provide. And St. Paul, in his letter to the Ephesians, in our second reading, is very clear. No? Paano natin ipapakita yung basic na paglilingkod? Tandaan nyo to, mga magulang. Sino ang mga magulang dito? Taas ang kamay. Wagayway nyo. Yan. Ibabaan nyo na. Yung mga magugulang. Madami ba? Oh. Mga magulang, tandaan nyo to ha. Forget me after. Tandaan nyo to. Paano kayo magsiserve? Ang pinakamagandang service po na ibibigay nyo sa inyong pamilya, sa inyong anak, hindi ho yung latest gadget, top of the line, whatever. Ang pinaka maganda na maipapakita nyo sa inyong anak na paglilingkod ay yung ipakita nyong kayong dalawa ay nagkakasundo. May away, may LQ, pero nagkakasundo na pag-uusapan. Kaya nga si St. Paul, no, sa kalawang pagbasa, maliwanag. Sabi niya sa mga nanay, 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 et, nakinig ba kayo kanina sa second reading? Anong sabi ni St. Paul sa mga nanay? Wives, wives, oh, ito nyo, alam nyo? Wives, ano yon? Submit yourselves to your husbands. Amen? Ba't kaya sinabi ni St. Paul yun, no? Sa mga nanay, nagpapasakop ba kayo? Kasi maraming nanay, maraming asawa, hindi nagpapasakop sa kanilang mga mister. No? Magpasakop kayo. Magpasakop si St. Paul yan. Submit yourselves. Bakit? Kasi sa plano ng Diyos, ang tatay, ang head ng pamilya. You might have differences, but we have to submit ourselves. Mag-usap kayo. Pag-usapan nyo. Alamin nyo yung plano ng Diyos. And at the end of the day, dapat unanimity of heart, you align yourselves with the decision of the head of the family. Merong isang nanay, no, isang wife, kaibigan namin, yung kanyang husband ay nag-a-apply for promotion. Gusto nung nag-a-apply yung ano, Father pray, lahat ng kaibigan niyang pare at mother, hiningan niya ng dasal. Sabi niya, Father, pray mo naman yung asawa ko. O bakit? Eh, nag-a-apply ho ng promotion eh. Anong position ba ina-applyan? Father, mataas, vice president ng company. Eh, ilan ba ang contender dyan? Father, tatlo. O sige, sige, ipagdasal natin. No? Pinagdasal ko naman, pinagdasal naman namin. Yun nga lang, sa kasamaang palad, hindi ho na-promote. So yung husband, lulugulugo, pag-uwi, syempre, natural, no? Hindi ka na-promote. Nag-apply kang VP, hindi ka na-promote. Pag-uwi niya, lulugulugo, buti na lang yung wife niya, very positive ang outlook. Kinomfort siya. Sabi niya, Dad, okay lang. Don't worry. It's not the end of the world. Hindi ka man na-promote na vice president. Remember, sa bahay natin, lagi ka namang vice president, no? mabuhay ang mga vice presidents na nandito ngayon. Eric. Mga magulang, no? Mga nanay, tatay, magpasakop kayo, no? Mga nanay, tatay, magpasakop kayo. Mga nanay, magpasakop kayo sa inyong asawa. No? Kasi hindi pwede, hindi ang maraming magulang yung ang term ho ng mga Italiano diyan ay bella figura. Ulitin niyo nga. Ano yung bella figura? Nagpapapogi sa anak. Kunyari nagpaalam kanino, no, sa nanay o pa hindi pinayagan yung isa papayagan. Sino yung mas pogi sa anak? Sino yung mas pabor sa anak nila? Yung nagbigay ng permission. Dapat nag-uusap kayo, merong teamwork. Amen. Hindi yung hiwalay, no? Para kasi may minsan unwritten 'yan eh. Nagpapapogi, nagpapaganda, nagpapabella figura sa anak. No? Pero mag-usap kayo, ang last say dapat nasa kay Mister. Tuwan-tuwa yung mga lalaki. Go, Father, go. May kilala akong ganyan, talagang strong guy. Ah. Sabi niya, ako, sa bahay namin, ako ang hari. Ako ang boss, sabi nung Mister. Ako ang may last say sa lahat ng bagay. Anong last say mo? Yes, sweetheart. May last say ba kayo? Pero hindi diyan nagtatapos sapagkat sabi ni St. Paul din kanina sa kalawang pagbasa. Sabi rin ni San Pablo, no? Husbands, listen, husbands, love your wives. How? As Christ loves the church. Mahalin nyo ang inyong asawa. No? Married life is not a popularity contest. You have to face your children as one. Kaya nga dito sa Ebanghelyo, sa second reading, sabi, the two becomes one. By the way, sinabi two, ha? Hindi three. That's why, husbands, love your wife, and only your wife. So, huwag nang tingin ng tingin kung saan-saan. Mahalin mo lang si Mrs. Wala nang iba. Mrs., magpasakop ka kay Mister. Kahit malaki ang sweldo mo kesa kanya. That's the best service we can render to our children. Alam niyo yung mga iba, add-ons na lang yan eh. Good school, top-of-the-line gadgets, cell phones, and every. Those are all add-ons. I've met a lot of children who are not happy because their parents are always fighting. Apektado yung mga bata. Maliit na bagay, nakasinghal na kayo. And I have met also children who have serenity, who have peace of mind, even if they are poor, because their parents love, honor, and respect each other. Wala pong eskwelahan, wala akong alam na eskwelahan na pwedeng humilot sa damage na magagawa ng magulang na laging nag-aaway. You do not know the damage that it can inflict on your children when we always fight and quarrel over anything. No school. I haven't known any school. Even if you send them to whatever school you think is the best, they can never heal the wounds inflicted by our fighting and these constant disagreements. Brothers and sisters, let us heed Joshua's proclamation. As for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. How will you serve the Lord? By singing? Add-on na lang yan. By being a lector? Add-on na lang yan. By being a marshal? Add-on na lang yan. The best way to serve the Lord is to be a good, true father, mother, and spouse to your family. And how you do that? Do we do that? Basic. Show them, show our children that we are one. How do we do that? By loving. Loving each other as Christ loves us. And so this tonight, I would like to ask you, no? Mamayang gabi, bago kayo matulog, mag-muni-muni naman tayo maski papano. Ha? Wala naman pasok bukas. Tama ba? Oh, medyo mag-muni-muni kayo. Pwedeng-pwede yan. Bago kayo matulog, simpleng tanong. Tanongin natin ang ating sarili. What kind of service do I render to God? Amen? What kind of service do I render to God? Is it mga add-ons lang? Secondary? Or the most basic service I should give? What kind of service do I render to God? And let's ask ourselves further, am I a good, true mother and spouse? Am I a good, true husband and father to my family? Magsitayo tayong lahat, ating ipahayag ang ating pananampalataya. I believe in God,
the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
And the needs and concerns of our community, of our family. For every petition, let us say, Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the church may continue to teach and live Christ's truth and help unbelievers to seek God's will, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That political and civil leaders may always opt for what is right and just, and not succumb to the temptations of power, influence, and financial gain. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That consecrated men and women be filled with joy, wisdom, and faithfulness, so that they may follow Christ more closely. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the sick and those who suffer may be freed from their bodily and spiritual afflictions. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for all families, for all Christian families especially, that we may learn, may we deepen our love, respect, and understanding to each member of our family. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Father, we ask all of this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Please be seated.
Turuan mo akong maglingkod sa iyo.
brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of His name, for our good and the good of all His holy church.
O Lord, who gained for yourself a people by adoption, through the one sacrifice offered once for all, bestow graciously on us, we pray, the gifts of unity and peace in your church, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in you we live and move and have our being. And while in this body, we not only experience the daily effects of your care, but even now possess the pledge of life eternal. For having received the first fruits of the Spirit, through whom you raise up Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in the Paschal mystery. And so with all the angels, we praise you as in joyful celebration we acclaim. Of all holiness, make holy therefore these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Let us proclaim the mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church is spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Jesse, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy, welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Beloved children of our Father, and so with confidence we call out to him using the prayer Jesus himself has taught us. Lord, we pray from every evil, graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace. Peace be with you. called Jesus our risen Lord, the Lamb of God who takes away our sins and the sins of the world. Happy are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. For an orderly receiving of Holy Communion by Rose, please allow our ushers to guide you.
Your feet, my desires and dreams I lay down.
Stand.
Let us pray. Complete within us, O Lord, we pray, the healing work of your mercy, and graciously perfect and sustain us, so that in all things we may please you, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. In behalf of the entire Feast Bellevue AM family, let us thank our Mass Presider, Reverend Father Ed Fernandez, for celebrating the Holy Eucharist with us.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. The Mass has been offered. Let us go in the peace of Christ.
Thanks be to God. Thank you.